Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good morning, everyone. You're welcome to Ballyfermot Community Church on this beautiful day. You know, we have to give thanks to God because yesterday was great. Today will be better, okay? Yeah, we have to look on the bright side. So I'm just going to share with you the scripture from the word for today on the Bible app. And it's from John 7, 37 to 38. So I'm going to be reading the CSB version. On the last and most important day of the festival, Jesus stood up and cried out, "If anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. The one who believes in me, as the scripture has said, will have streams of living water flow from deep within him." Hallelujah. Today, let us look up to God. Let us look up to Jesus, because that is where our help comes from. So I'll just encourage you to stand up. Open your heart. Be open to the blessing you're going to receive today, and just fellowship and worship with the Lord. Amen.
Amen. Alrighty, good morning, everyone. So we're going to go into a time of worship right now. And it's pretty rainy, but we are always joyful. So we want to be joyful this morning. We want to have loads of energy. Amen. So we are going to begin. Amen. Father God, as you start today's service, I pray that you open our ears to listen to what you have to say to us, Lord. I pray that you open our hearts, Lord, to just receive from you, God. And Holy Spirit, I pray that you come into this place, Lord, and just fill our presence in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life so I would be set free. Oh Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're just going to continue to come around the word of the Lord and the message of the Lord. And, you know, we have a prayer slot on a Sunday every now and then, and we focus on a particular group. So this week, we just wanted to focus for a few moments on the Serbian-speaking Jewish population in Serbia. You wonder, what's that all about, like, you know? But, you know, we've been called on mission to go and preach the good news to all corners of the earth. And, you know, this group of Serbian-speaking Jewish people in Serbia, there's 1,200 of them there. There's only 1,800 of them in the whole world. And they live in three different countries. But today we're just focusing on the Serbian group. And there's 1,200 of them there. Within Serbia, there is ethnic religious groups and factions. But you know, there's no Christian groups, there's no evangelical groups, there's no population group to count in Serbia. And it's interesting that, you know, every time we look at these unreached people groups, we see missionaries and we see people who go there and we see people who try to make an impact. They give their lives basically to doing this. But there's no resident population of Christian or evangelical groups in the country. And so how do we reach those people? You know, we can uphold them in prayer, and we trust that the Lord our God will actually move through his Holy Spirit in Serbia and reach into these groups and just open their hearts. Amen. The Serbian Jewish population is very small now, and right across Eastern Europe. Would you believe that the Jewish population across Eastern European countries used to be the biggest population of Jews in the whole world? But now, after the Holocaust and after various wars and after various conflicts that have taken place, particularly in the last 25, 30 years across these regions, the population has dwindled. And one of the things that they found that's happening as well is that the younger Jewish population there either don't practice or don't have a tradition of faith anymore. They would identify as Jewish, but they're finding it really difficult because the older population is staying where they are, but the younger population is immigrating, and an awful lot of them have immigrated to America, but a huge number have also immigrated back to Israel. And we see a gathering back in Israel of the Jewish population from all across the world, and Serbia is no different. So right now there's only 1,200 of them there, but we want to lift them in prayer. And one of the prayer points that we have for the Jewish people, not just in Serbia, but right across the world, is a softening of their hearts, because they historically would reject Jesus as the Lord and Savior, as the Messiah. But, you know, we have been revealed the good news. We have been so blessed. And, you know, we just know our Lord and Savior on a personal level, in a relational level. And it's just absolutely amazing. But we should never take that for granted. And we should understand as well that within these Jewish groups, they're waiting for the Messiah still. Some of them believe he's here right now. Some of them are waiting for this big revelation of when he will come. But an awful lot of them reject Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. And so we need a softening of their hearts. We need them to understand that the good news gospel is not anti-Semitic. It's not something that we are preaching or praying or sharing or even just in our actions to bless them and to show them what the Lord our God has done for us. But it's not anti-Semitic. It's not meant to be against them. It's not meant to upset them, annoy them, belittle them. It's actually meant to give them the good news. It's meant to uplift them. It's meant to encourage them. It's meant to give them hope and peace and love and joy in the knowledge of the Lord our God. Amen. They are firmly believing people in the Lord our God, but they don't believe in Jesus, most of them. And that's a sad situation to find it. So as we just stand, maybe today, we'll just lift up these people, particularly the Serbian-speaking Jewish population, but in general, Jews across the world, that they will have their hearts softened and they will open their ears to hear the good news. And the Lord our God will be able to drop that message into their heart and plant a seed to give them understanding at this time. So we might just stand and pray, and then we're going to go back into a time of worship. Lord God, we're just so blessed, Lord, to know you. We're just so blessed to be able to share in the good news, Lord. We're so blessed, Lord, that you have opened our hearts and our minds, that you have given us the love and peace and understanding and knowledge and wisdom of you, Lord. Lord, everything that we do is about you, Lord. Everything that we are is about you, Lord. Lord, we just are so blessed, Lord, at this time, Lord. And we just give you all the thanks and praise, Lord. And Lord, we just ask for that move of your Holy Spirit amongst the Jewish populations, Lord. Just to touch, reach down and touch their hearts, Lord. Bring people across their path, Lord, that are going to show them the light of Jesus, that are going to show them the love of Jesus, that are going to demonstrate to them the good news. Lord, just as we have heard the good news and have been so blessed, Lord, we want them to be blessed too, Lord. Lord, we want them to have a softening of their hearts, of their minds, of their understanding, Lord, just to be open to hear the good news, Lord, because we know that when we hear the good news, Lord, and we can see that light shining on the hill, Lord, Lord, that you cannot help but be impacted by it. In Jesus' name we pray. We're just going to take up the tithes and offering on the next song, and we're going to go into this time of worship now and just really encourage you all just to have your hearts and minds focused on those unreached people groups. Thank you.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship you, 'cause you are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, you're working in this place. I worship you, I worship you, 'cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, That is who you are. 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 You are Him. You're touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. 'Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. 'Cause you are waymaker, miracle worker, promise light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. See, that is who you are. 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 Jesus, that is who you are. That is who you are. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Even when I can see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you are the way. In the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
That is who you are.
Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst from a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Of Jesus Christ. And oh, what a Savior. Wonderful. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord. There's no reason to wait. lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender.
Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, because we don't have to wait to come to you, Lord. There's no reason to wait. We can come to you right now. You're waiting for us, Lord. Thank you, Lord, because we don't have to be perfect to be in your presence, Lord. But thank you, Lord, because you want all the imperfect people so that then you can make them perfect. Thank you, Lord. I pray, Lord, that we make room for you in our lives, and that as we go out into the world where so many other things are trying to, you know, are trying to just take us away from you, Lord, I pray that we'll be able to fix our eyes on you, God. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy, your grace. Thank you, Lord, for the blood. For in Jesus' name I pray, amen. And the kids can now go upstairs for Sunday school.
Can we just show our appreciation today as well for the sound and media team and everyone at the back that does such a great job week in, week out. We have audio stuff, we have media stuff, we have the screens, we have live stream. There's a lot going on back there, and those guys make it look easy. So thank you so much to all of you. Yeah, that's right, definitely. Faithful, faithful servants. Hello, everyone. What a joy to be in church again today. And you know what? See, at the minute, there is a feeling, isn't there, that God is on the move. Something is stirring in a number of us in this church, which is really exciting. And of course, there are other things going on, and you might not be feeling like that today, and that's okay. But just to be encouraged today that there's also something stirring in a number of people in our church. We are finishing our series today that we want you to see yourself as God sees you. So today is the last day. We've talked about being a citizen of heaven. We've talked about being a child of God. We've talked about being a new creation. We've talked about being a saint. And today we're going to finish with looking at this a bit more practically. In other words, what do I do with these revelations? What do I do with this thought that I want to see myself as God sees me? So one last time, I will ask us all, where are you at on this journey? When you look in the mirror, what do you see? Who do you see? What do you think about yourself? Are the things that you say about yourself and the thoughts that you think lined up with Scripture? Or do you believe lies? Do you focus on the wrong things and all the rest? What do I do with the revelation that I am a citizen of heaven? I am a child of God. I am a new creation. I am a saint. And so if we had a title for today, it would be this: God sees more in you than you see in yourself. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. Let us read together from Ephesians 2 and verses 1 to 10. I believe it should come up on the screen. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you previously walked according to the ways of this world, according to the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit now working in the disobedient. We too all previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and thoughts, and we were by nature children under wrath, as the others were also. But God, could end it there, couldn't I? But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love that he had for us, made us alive with Christ, even though we were dead in trespasses. You are saved by grace. He also raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might display the immeasurable riches of his grace through his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For you are saved by grace through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is God's gift, not from works, so that no one can boast. For we are his workmanship, or another version says masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time for us to do. We were dead, weren't we, in trespasses and sins? We too all previously lived among them in our fleshly desires, carrying out the inclinations of our flesh and our thoughts. We were by nature children under wrath. That's what the scripture says. Verse 4, but God, God saw more in us than we could ever see in ourselves. We were dead, but he saw life. Verse 5, he made us alive with Christ. Even though we were dead in trespasses, you are saved by grace. Anyone say amen to that? And amazingly, he didn't just make us alive from being dead and make us his servants. Verse 6, he also raised us up with him. These are verses to meditate on in Ephesians 2. They're mind-blowing. Seated us with him in the heavens in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might display the immeasurable riches of his grace through his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. And then verse 10, for we are his workmanship. We are his masterpiece, created anew in Christ Jesus to do the good things he planned for us, prepared ahead of time for us in order for us to do. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. Turn to someone else and say it to them. Point your finger if you want. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. Because let's be honest, we couldn't see it in ourselves, could we? Often we can't see it in ourselves. Most of us, if not all of us, understand that we are so far from being like Jesus. When we look in the mirror at times, we see how far we are from being like Jesus. We have come so far in ways, many of us, than we could ever have imagined. And often that is confirmed by other people's reactions to us. It's why testimonies are so powerful. People meet us that haven't seen us in years and think, there's no way that's such and such. There's no way that's you from school. There's no way that that's you that I met a couple of years ago, and whatever the stories might be. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. And at its beginnings, it is being made alive with Christ from death. But that amazing transformation of becoming new creations continues throughout our walk with God, continues throughout our discipleship journey. And God is consistent, isn't he? So we see this pattern throughout Scripture. Can I take you through a couple of these right now? Abraham. God took a man named Abraham, who he had promised his descendants would be as numerous as the grains of sand on this seashore. And he made him a father at 100 years old. Come on. Only the power of God, right? Sarah was 90 years old and Isaac was born. God saw something in them that they didn't see in themselves. What about Joseph? At the start of Joseph's story, his brothers see that their father loves him more than all his other brothers. They hated him and they could not bring themselves to speak peaceably to him. And years later then, Joseph is telling them in Genesis 45 and verse 8, therefore it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, lord of his entire household, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. What about Moses? When God asked Moses to go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt, let's read it together from Exodus 4 and verses 10 to 17, which should also come up on the screen. Exodus 4 and verses 10 to 17. Maybe someone could give them a wee nod there. But Moses replied to the Lord, please, Lord, I have never been eloquent, either in the past or recently or since you have been speaking to your servant, because my mouth and my tongue are sluggish. Right? Anyone else have excuses when God asks them to do something? Yeah, just tell the truth. Verse 11, then the Lord said to him, who placed a mouth on humans? Who makes a person mute or deaf, seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak, and I will teach you what to say. Exodus 4 and verse 13, Moses said, please, Lord, send someone else. At least he's honest, right? Verse 14, then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, isn't Aaron the Levite your brother? I know that he can speak well, and also he is on his way now to meet you. He will rejoice when he sees you. You will speak with him and tell him what to say. I will help both you and him to speak and will teach you both what to do. He will speak to the people for you. He will serve as a mouth for you, and you will serve as God to him. And take the staff in your hand that you will perform the signs with. And look at how Moses goes on to be used for God's glory. God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. By chapter 14, he is stretching out his hand over the Red Sea and leading the Israelites across it on dry ground. Isn't our God amazing? He sees more in us than we see in ourselves. What about the 12 spies in Numbers 13? Sent out to scout out the land of Canaan. 10 of them came back saying what? The people in the land are strong. The cities are large and fortified. The people are stronger than us. To ourselves, we seem like grasshoppers. And we must have seen the same to them. God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. We might say that we are like grasshoppers, but he sees something different, doesn't he? What about Joshua? What does the Lord have to say over and over again to Joshua in chapter 1 of this book? Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. I have given you every place where the sole of your foot treads. Your territory will be. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live. I will be with you. I will not leave you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. And that's all in the first 10 verses of Joshua chapter 1. Why? Because God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. He knew how Joshua felt. He knew what Joshua needed to hear. But he knew what Joshua would go on to do and how he would be used by God. What about Rahab in Joshua chapter 2? The world saw a prostitute. And God saw a woman who would hide his people and save their lives by helping them escape through a window. She appears 3 times in the New Testament, including Matthew's genealogy of Jesus. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. What about Ehud from Judges chapter 3? We talked about him in the summer in case some of you missed it or were on holiday. A left-handed man from the tribe of Benjamin. God used his perceived disadvantage that allowed him to get a one-to-one with the king. Only Ehud could have got that. And he went on to kill the king and lead the Israelites to victory. God sees more in you than you see in yourself. What about David from 1 Samuel 16? His father Jesse could only see the youngest boy who was out tending the sheep. But the Lord said to Samuel, anoint him, for he is the one. Anoint him, for he is the one. And look at what God went on to do through David's life. What about Esther or Jeremiah or Daniel or Josiah? What about John the Baptist, a man in camel hair eating locusts and honey? God sees more in you than you see in yourself. What about the centurion servant or Lazarus or any of the disciples except Judas or the thief on the cross or Mary Magdalene announcing to the disciples, I have seen the Lord? What about Peter in the book of Acts or the lame man by the temple gate? What about the apostle Paul? What about the Gentiles? Or what about those from every nation, tribe, people, and language in the ends of the earth? Revelation 7 and verse 9 says this, after this I looked, and there was a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language, which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. We might put titles on ourselves. We might put labels. We might put a focus on our history. We might put a focus on where we feel we're at today. But God sees more in us than we even see in ourselves. The Lord definitely saw more in Balaam's donkey than I could ever see. Isn't he a good God? A couple of quick points today. First one is this, from glory to glory. We are being changed from glory to glory. 2 Corinthians 3 and verses 17 to 18. I'd encourage you to read the whole chapter at home. It's amazing, but let's focus on this verse 18 particularly. Verse 17, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Verse 18, we all with unveiled faces are looking as in a mirror at the glory of the Lord and are being transformed. Everybody say transformed. Into the same image from glory to glory. This is from the Lord who is the Spirit. One of the reasons that God sees more in us than we see in ourselves is that we cannot predict the change that will happen in our lives. And we experience that journey in real time, don't we? From day to day. We don't always see the big picture. It can be hard to grasp what God is doing. We also know all of our own desires and hidden thoughts and motivations and struggles like nobody else knows them in ourselves. But here's a promise that I want us all to be crystal clear on from God's word today. We all, with unveiled faces, are looking as in a mirror at the glory of the Lord and are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. God is working in our lives. He is doing. He is active. He is changing us and transforming us when we are followers of Jesus. So that challenge you're going through, not only is God interested in your challenge and working it through, He is interested in using that challenge to transform you and change you from glory to glory. Anyone experienced that before? That relationship rift that you're facing day in and day out. Not only is God interested in helping you through that and carrying your burdens, but He is interested in using it to transform you from glory to glory. Did you know that even though you were irresponsible with money and made a mess with your finances, that God is still the provider and wants to walk you through that, and He will use it to change us from glory to glory? Isn't that amazing? You maybe made a bad decision in your life, in your relationships, in your workplace, and God wants to walk you through it, and He uses it to change us from glory to glory. Why? Because He sees more in us than we see in ourselves. At times we feel like there's no hope. At times we feel like there's no change. At times we feel like there's no way we'll ever overcome that or get through that or whatever. But God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. And we are on that journey of being changed from glory to glory. Secondly today, God has prepared good works for us to do. Ephesians 2 and verse 10, for we are His workmanship. Or I said another version says masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared ahead of time for us to do. We are not saved by works. There are no works that we could do that could ever earn us salvation, that could ever earn us what Jesus Christ has done for us. That is a complete misunderstanding of the gospel. But we are saved for works. Afterwards, we are saved to do good works that He prepared in advance for us to do. And that is not a negative thing at all. It is a beautiful thing. God took time preparing, as if God needs to prepare for anything. But God took time preparing good works for you and I to do. Who would want to miss out on that? Who would want to be involved in that? Who would want to lose out on the privilege that that is? So when He saved Balu, I'm going to give him these assignments. And he will get the privilege of doing these good works for me and with me. When He saved Colleen, I'm going to give her these assignments. She will get the privilege of using her gifts and working alongside me, serving these people. And the reality is, it's not about what those good works are, really, or how noticed we are by other people or anything else. It's about us doing what He prepared for us. Each individual, each uniquely, what did He give for us to do? God sees more in us than we could ever see in ourselves. And it's just as well, isn't it? What a relief. Because this East Belfast lad never saw himself at 14 ever leaving East Belfast. At 14, I imagined that maybe someday I would get to lead worship or preach a sermon like once or twice. And my life has looked very different from that. And it's not about titles or positions. One of the reasons I don't particularly like being called pastor, although I'm very grateful for those of you that are so polite, is because while I take the responsibility very seriously and consider it a privilege, but I would never want anyone to assume that because I have a title, that I in any way think or feel that I am more important than you. Because the kingdom of God doesn't work like that with our good works. I have my assignment and you have yours. And we can't take that away from each other. We get on with the good works that he has prepared for us to do, whatever that looks like. And when I preached for the first time in Ballyfermot Community Church 10 years ago, because Dave Galvin asked a young man to cover his holiday preach and yelled at me from across the minister's meeting and said, "Don't wreck my church," just saying, I never imagined that this church would be one of my assignments. But what a privilege. Isn't that right? And whether your assignment is to be a pastor or to pray or to encourage or lead worship or do multimedia and sound or to teach in Sunday school or to be a parent or to be a grandparent or to serve the Lord in kindness to others, in provision, whatever your assignments might be, God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. So much so that he prepared these good works in advance for us to do. He prepared those good works for me to do. So I had better figure out how to get on with that. Is anyone with me? Yeah? Thirdly and lastly, we get to partner with God in reaching the neighborhoods, cities, and nations of the world. So whether that's out there in Ballyfermot, whether that's Dublin, whether that's Ireland, or whether that's the nations, we get to partner with God in doing that. What a privilege, right? Jesus said to all of us in Matthew 28, verses 18 to 20, Jesus came near and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And teach these new disciples to obey everything I have commanded. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the ends of the age." But the Great Commission wasn't a millstone around their necks. It wasn't a chore to the disciples or the early church or the church that has gone before us. It wasn't something we were meant to fit in around everything else. Jesus said to all of us, go and make disciples of all nations so that we could partner with him in the redemption of communities, in the redemption of neighborhoods, in the redemption of cities and the nations of the world. And what a privilege that is. And that's what we're attempting to do in and through our church. God has great purpose for your life. He has great purpose in saving us, in transforming us from glory to glory. He has great purpose in using us to do the good works that he prepared for us to do. I'm going to ask Esther to come up and just play quietly, please, if you don't mind. So what do we do with this series? I pray that every day for the rest of your life, you're able to see more of what Jesus Christ has done for us in saving us, what he has truly achieved on the cross and through his resurrection, to see the citizen of heaven that you are, to see the child of God that you are, to see the new creation that you are, to see the saint that you are. And I pray that from this identity that he has given us, we see that he has created us to do great things. He has created us to do good works that he planned for us long ago, not for ourselves, but for his glory. I'm aware today that for some people, this last season of life, this last couple of years, has changed how active that we were in the things that God has called us to do. I wonder if I could ask you today, is now the time to re-engage in all of the good works that God has called you to? It's now the time to re-engage again with that sense of love that compels us to do what God has asked us to do. To re-engage with that vision or those promises or just knowing what God has put inside of you that the rest of the world is not getting to see at this time. I'm aware today that perhaps that might be a struggle for some of you. We would like to pray for some people today at the end as we finish. Now, if you would like prayer, some of the leaders will be up here today and you feel free to come forward. We would love to pray with you. Maybe you're saying today, do you know, I know that God sees more in me than I see in myself. And I need something of the Holy Spirit to remind me of those good things that I've been created in advance to do. Some of you might have some hurdles to get over in order to do everything that God has called you to. There's no day like today to begin that journey towards some hurdle jumping or just kicking them out of the way. It's more my style. What is God saying to us? Hurdles of fear, of doubt, feeling unworthy, confused, lack of clarity about our calling, all sorts of reasons, all sorts of things that could be going on in our hearts. But I just wanted to remind you today on the strength of the Word of God, that down through the ages, God sees more in us than we see in ourselves. And we are His masterpiece, created anew in Christ Jesus to do the good things He planned for us long ago. God saw this day. He knows what He prepared for you in this next season of your life. And I pray that we all step into that, knowing that while we may not see it some days, while it takes an element of faith, while it takes an element of strength and courage to step out of the boat and get on with what He's called us to do, that He will empower us to do that. He will give us the grace. He will enable us by His Spirit to be all that He has called us to be. Let's stand together as we pray in this moment. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Father God, we give You our own thoughts and feelings in this moment. Because I'm aware at times that in a message like this, that some of that can rise up very strongly within us. We don't want to live our lives following You based on our own thoughts and feelings. But we want to be people of faith that You have called us and created us to be. Father God, we would never want anyone in this church to spend the years of their lives, however short or long that might be, and not fulfill their potential in You. So Father God, in this moment, we pray against the lies of the enemy that have invaded our lives and our thoughts for far too long, that have held us down, that have shut us up, that have kept us from running after You and Your purposes. Father God, I pray that they would be broken today over people's lives. Father God, I pray in this moment by Your Spirit that You would fill us to overflowing. Father God, I pray in this moment that we would even see a glimpse of what You see when You look at us, as You change us from glory to glory, as we step into the good works that You have called us to do, as we are aware that we get to partner with You in seeing change happen in other people's lives. What a privilege. Father God, I just pray over every saint in this room, every child of God, every citizen of heaven, every new creation, that they would rise up in faith, in love, in grace, in mercy, in joy, in peace, that they would run after You, that they would do every good work that You have called them to do, that You might get all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
The Lord gave me a vision of olives, and He showed me the church as olives, and He wants to squeeze us so the anointing will come out. But the Holy Spirit is such a gentleman, He won't squeeze you unless you want Him to. And the Lord says to me, He doesn't want all of us to focus on the outside looking good. He wants us to focus on looking good on the inside. So I just wondered, would you allow the Holy Spirit to search you? Will you ask the Lord to purify you? But before you ask Him, I just want to let you know, it's not an easy process. It's uncomfortable when the Lord squeezes you. Sometimes he asks you to lay down parts of your personality. That's not easy. Sometimes it's pride. Sometimes it's stubbornness. Sometimes it's just having the last word. Sometimes it's your thinking. But will you allow him today? I'm just going to pray. Father God, I thank you that your desire is for us to be purified so that we can stand before you, Lord God, holy and pure. Holy Spirit, I just ask you now that you purify your church and all those who want to be squeezed, Lord, squeeze us, Lord, including myself, so that we can be pure and holy and that the anointing will flow from us so we can do all the good works, Lord God, that you have planned for us. I thank you, Lord, for the work that you're doing in us. I thank you for purifying us. In the mighty name of Jesus, Lord, have your way.
We're just going to go back into a time of worship. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every
your praise. Our hearts will cry.
these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
So great in our lives. Thank you, Lord, that we know our identity in you. Amen. And thank you, Lord, because we now understand how you see us. And even though we might feel little, but Lord, we know that we're bigger than what we think we are. We know that your vision and your plan is better and bigger for us, Lord. So thank you, Lord, for that. Amen. Great to you, Lord.
Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're a God of power. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Prophesy to the breath. I prophesy to the breath. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thanks. Just a moment, we're going to take communion together. Two big truths actually have been very precious to me for many, many years now. Jesus is Lord. And Jesus loves me. Okay, Jesus is Lord and Jesus loves me. And those truths have helped me through the darkest times in my life. It's amazing. Jesus loves me. And he loves you too. But you know something that I think Jesus loves at least as much, maybe even a little bit more than you, is you in communion with your brother and your sister sitting next to you right here, right now. Jesus loves you as a brotherhood and sisterhood. Is there a word to pull them both together? Brothers and sisters in the Lord here as church together. There's a beautiful Psalm 133. Look it up sometime. And it says it's a beautiful thing. How beautiful and how pleasant it is when brothers and sisters dwell together in unity. When we're here together in unity, and I have the privilege you don't have right now, I can look at you and see what an odd-looking bunch you are. And okay, and when I sit down there, it's even more odd-looking. But yeah, you're an odd-looking bunch, in honesty here now. And I look down and think, wow, how in the world could this bunch of people get along together? And the answer is Jesus binds us together. And when Jesus binds us together, it's a beautiful thing. And when God looks at that, it is so, so, so precious to him that we're in communion. What does communion mean? It means we're together. We're fellowshipping together. We're doing something together. We're working on something together. And I love the whole series we've been going through about seeing ourselves in the mirror and, you know, what does God see when he looks at us? But I know when I look in the mirror, I'm a step ahead of you guys because I get up in the morning. I'm good to go. You know, I got my hair ready. It's good. I have less work, a bit of water on my face. But, you know, we've all got to get our gaze back in that mirror and say, you know, Lord, help me to see what you see. But even more as a church, Lord, help us to see what you see in us as a church. You know, what can we be together? And then there's another verse I thought of just yesterday in Hebrews 10:20. I think it's 10:25. It's around there somewhere. It's in Hebrews where God talks about us not neglecting to meet together as brothers and sisters. You know, some of us maybe got up this morning thinking like, oh, I don't feel like it, but I'm going to make myself go in there because probably ought to. You know what? It's a privilege. It's a blessing for us to be here together as brothers and sisters. And I think about maybe we could start to just share around the elements there, the bread and the juice, if you would. Thank you. When I think of Jesus, when at that last supper that he had with the disciples, and he held aloft the bread, and he broke it apart, and he was thinking about us as believers. As he broke that bread represented the body, his body broken for us. Thank you. Broken for us. And he said, this is my body broken for you. And he was thinking about how much he loved you guys as community. And then he took the glass of wine, we've got juice here, and he began to pass that around. He said, this is my blood of the covenant, which shed for you. That blood that was spilled to pay the price for all of the wrong things I did and you did. He loved you that much. It was such a precious thing to him. So as we take this communion together, remember, we are a community. That is so important to God. And we're going to remember what he did. And as we do this together, and I want you to think, what did Jesus do for me? What has Jesus done for me? What's some of the things he's taken me through? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this bread. We thank you for this juice, Lord, that represents your body and your blood, that represents the great thing that you did for us, that represents the continual love that you have for us as brothers and sisters. Lord, as we take this together now, would you bless this to our bodies? As you have loved us and continue to love us, Lord, we love you. Thank you for placing us together here this morning in this room as brothers and sisters, even for those who couldn't make it this morning. Lord, I pray that you preserve this unity, that you hedge us around with your protection, and that you bless this church, this body of believers. We love you and adore you. And as we take this bread and this juice now together, we love you and we bless you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's take these together.
Amen. Hallelujah. So I'm just going to share with you the announcements before we close in prayer. So can we have the announcement up on the screen? So every Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, we do have a pre-service prayer. So it's out in the manor shop, so everyone is welcome. Woo-hoo! Woo! Yeah. If you're thinking, oh yeah, coming at 10, and then what will I be doing between 10 and half 11? There is loads to do. Trust me, you'll keep yourself busy. We'll be able to keep you busy. So we encourage you, join us at 10 o'clock for the pre-service prayer. And then on Tuesday at 11 a.m. here in the church, we have the women's Bible study. So happy days. Yeah, those that are regular attendants, they're the ones clapping. Yeah. So we encourage you to join them. And like I think it was Bolu that said it last week, if you're lucky enough, you get cake. So there's cakes, coffees, and all that. There's always cakes. They do. Ross brings cake and Gertie. So yeah, that's at 11 o'clock on Tuesday morning. And then at 12 p.m., there's the intercessory prayer. So everyone is welcome. It's important we intercede for one another. And then on Wednesday at 8 p.m., we have the Zoom Bible study. And we are on Acts chapter 19. Woo-hoo! Yeah. We need the numbers. We need the numbers. You know, we started off really great, and then we started going, and now we need to keep the numbers up. So it's at 8 o'clock. You don't need to travel anywhere. You can be in your jammies. You can be having your tea or dinner. Several times Alan has been cooking, and we're all there sitting at the table waiting for the food to be served. So you don't have to leave your home. Just join us online for that. And it's at 8 p.m. on Wednesday, Acts chapter 19. So the link to the Zoom link will be posted before Wednesday. So Monday and Tuesday, you'll get the Zoom link on WhatsApp. Thursday at 8 p.m. is the Holy Spirit night. Woo-hoo! I can see it's only Pastor Craig alone doing woo-hoo. Let's cheer up, yeah? Thursday at 8 p.m. is the Holy Spirit night. Ooh, hallelujah. Yeah. So join us at 8 p.m. here in Ballyfermot. Bring friends, bring families, bring people who need prayer. You know, the Lord is doing wonderful things amongst us. And then we have on the 28th to the 31st of October, we have the Zealous Weekend. And this is all youth age 12 to 18. So details is on the posters. Speak to Pastor Craig, speak to Gabriel, speak to Bolu if you need more information.
I'm praying. There's 15 of us going from
Ballyfermot. Hallelujah. 15 youth, including their teachers. Listen, the Lord is doing wonderful things in Ballyfermot. Hallelujah. So keep them in prayer. Ask for journey mercy, that the Lord will minister unto them as they go and fellowship with other youths across for that period. And then on the 20th of November, Sunday the 20th of November, is our next Go Kids! Yeah, we had a wonderful time starting off again for the new season. That was last week, yeah. I'm ready for the next one. Yeah. We had a wonderful time last week. So the next one is the 20th of November from 3 to 4:30 p.m. Invite your neighbors, invite the kids, invite your friends. Kids, invite your friends. So we hope to see you soon. And also, I would like to say Mission Globes, if you have Mission Globes or you took one in the last couple of weeks or months, if you want to bring them back to us, we'll empty them, let you know how much you've actually contributed to international missions, and then we give you back to you. So, but if you haven't picked up one, speak to me after the service. I have loads of them in the back room. Spare change, you know what? I know they're trying to go cashless and everything, but we still have the odd change here and there. So speak to me and I'll get you a Mission Globe. So it's for international mission. So any loose coins or loose notes. Some people don't like having €5 notes in their purse. So you can drop it in there. So yeah, speak to me. And if you have the globe, if you want to return it back so that we can count it and then give it back to you, that would be great. Information cards are out there. Please fill them out, either with pen or online using the QR code. And if you have any issues, speak to Gabrielle. We have the shoebox appeal out there in the foyer. So Christmas is coming. It's the season to be jolly, isn't it? Oh, am I the only one jolly this season? It's the season to be jolly. So we need to put a smile on kids' faces, the children that are less privileged, that would be having difficulty spending Christmas. But when they get all these shoe boxes, you can see their faces lit up. We'll be showing videos about where this box is goes to. Look, you know, showing you videos about the reaction of the children. So we encourage you to actually take one, start, you know, taking them now to complete. Oh, I'm trying to unlock this, and it's
Sunday 13th of November. Sunday
13th of November. So it's early this time around. 3 weeks today. So pick up as many boxes. There's information leaflet in terms of different age groups, boys and girls, what needs to go in and what you shouldn't put in there. Perishable foods and things like that are not, you know, they're not accepted. But you'll have the information there. So pick a shoebox or as many as the Lord, you know, lay in your heart, and you'll be putting €5 in each box. That is to cover the cost of transportation to actually transport it to the countries where they'll be distributing to the children. If you haven't joined WhatsApp group, please speak to Pastor Craig, Rob, Gabrielle, myself, any one of the leaders. You know, we'll be happy to add your name to the BBC announcement. That's where we actually post all information about what's going on during the week and other events that we'll be having. Sign up and follow us on Facebook, Instagram. I don't think we're on Twitter. No. Instagram and Facebook. So, hallelujah. Let's close our eyes and pray. Father, Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for the blessing which we have received. We thank you for, you know, ministering to us, oh Lord. We thank you because you're a good God. You're a good Father, Lord. Thank you for all that you have done. Thank you for all that you're doing. And we thank you for all that you will be doing, O Lord, in our lives. As we set off this week, O Lord, Father, bless us, O God. Guide our steps. Protect us, O Lord, from every evil, O Lord. Guide our footsteps, O Lord. Father, Lord, so that when we come back again and we gather together again, we will have full cause to glorify your holy name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. 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 We'll be right back.